Welcome. Gather around, class, so I can tell you the story of Antithrombin 3 and the blood coagulation cascade. Our story begins in the human body with our hero, Antithrombin 3. For the longest time, Antithrombin 3 went unrecognized for all the good he did. As Antithrombin 3 is the only medically relevant Antithrombin, we'll call him Antithrombin. We'll call him Antithrombin for short, for that's how most people refer to him currently. So what makes Antithrombin so special? He's composed of a mix of alpha helices and parallel beta sheets. At 432 residues long, with a good mix of polar and nonpolar residues, he's a perfect shape and size for a protease inhibitor. Being a blood protein, Antithrombin has a large number of polar residues on his external surface and some nonpolar residues hidden inside. Though he's composed mostly of uncharged residues, Antithrombin has enough charged residues to allow for the binding of cofactors and polysaccharides. In fact, Antithrombin has a specially shaped pocket designed to bind polysaccharides found in the blood, given that they have the correct sequence, of course. It's this pocket that allows AT to bind to the famous anticoagulant drug, heparin. Binding with heparin allows our friend to have greater affinity towards enzymatic targets like thrombin and active factor 10. Along with this pocket, Antithrombin also has various glycosylation sites. Four uniquely placed asparagine residues allow AT to pick up to four sugar molecules. Most of the time, AT carries around four, but on occasion, he leaves out one. But what does AT do, being a glycoprotein? As a serpene, AT is a part of an elite class of irreversible serine protease inhibitor proteins. When protease activity is wild, it's his job to stop them. Like other serpenes, Antithrombin has a reactive center loop, a flexible loop designed to change configurations when the right bonds are broken. It is only but a single serine and arginine bond that holds the loop in place. And now the time has come to get to work. With the help of some cofactors to increase protease affinity and recruitment, Antithrombin can finally begin catching these proteases. When the right serine protease comes along, he guides it towards his reactive center loop. The protease, in its attempt to sever the loop, ends up splitting the loop's serine-arginine bond. Without this stabilizing bond, Antithrombin's reactive loop is released, and Antithrombin springs into action. Before the protease can finish cutting, Antithrombin switches his conformation and finally forms the serpene protease complex he's always wanted to be. With this conformational change, the protease's serine, having been attached to the reactive loop, is pulled out of position. Its catalytic triad is no more, and Antithrombin remains attached to his protease friend. Now, it's important to note, Antithrombin is a popular protein who has more than just one protease friend. He also interacts with activated factors 12, 11, 10, 9, the cool proteins involved in the coagulation cascade. These proteins work together as a part of the intrinsic pathway of the coagulation cascade. Each is responsible for activating the next, and eventually end up activating the protease factor, factor 10. Antithrombin plays an important role in inhibiting the protease activity of the activated factor 10. But despite Antithrombin's involvement with the regulation of all these other factors, his closest friend, the one he makes his most important irreversible reactions with, is activated factor 2, also known as thrombin. Now, thrombin is the coolest of the coagulation factors. If you ever need fibrin and platelets to form blood clots, thrombin was the protease to call. His main job was trimming fibrinogen, which is the inactive form of fibrin. It's fibrin who forms the long strands and combines with platelets to form clots. Thrombin has other roles too, like activating various factors to increase clotting activity, to promote its own activation, and even to promote the production of antithrombin. There's a reason thrombin and antithrombin are so close. And while antithrombin always appreciated thrombin's efforts, in the end, thrombin couldn't stay around, as he was just too active. It was okay to let him out every now and then, but once the job of clotting was done, antithrombin had to inhibit the rest of thrombin. Antithrombin worked diligently, for he knew excess thrombin activity could lead to major problems. The biggest fear would be thrombophilia, excess clotting of the blood. Without antithrombin to keep thrombin down, blood clots would continue to build up along vesicle walls. Numerous enough or large enough clots would lead to blocked vessels and cell death. It's a good thing we have enough antithrombin. For some, that isn't the case. Causes of low antithrombin levels vary. Low levels can be caused by infection, disease of the liver or kidneys, and even pregnancy. Mutations in the genes encoding antithrombin can also have major effects, leading to a rare inherited disorder called antithrombin deficiency. With this disease, patients must take anticoagulants and other blood thinners continually. Doses of heparin may also be added to increase thrombin's activity. In any case, none of these serve to replace antithrombin. They only help to treat the symptoms of its insufficiency. So be thankful for your little serpine friend, antithrombin, for helping you to avoid a strict regimen of blood thinning medicine. Welcome.